When we read the news, we could easily get the impression that computers are these all-powerful machines that potentially can do anything you would want them to do. But is this really true? If we have some problem, does there always exist a Turing machine that solves that particular problem? The answer for this is no. There are problems for which no Turing machine exists that solves them. In fact, there are even decision problems, so problems which only require a yes or no answer, which cannot be decided by a Turing machine. And it is actually quite easy to see that such problems have to exist. First, realize that the set of all Turing machines is countable. So if we look at all Turing machines, there's some systematic way in which we can enumerate them all, so we can number them. Since every Turing machine can be represented by a bit string, and because bit strings of finite length are countable, the set of all Turing machines must also be countable. So there are only countably many different Turing machines. However, how many decision problems are there? Turns out that the set of all decision problems, so the set of all functions of the form that they map finite length bit strings to 0 or 1, is not countable. The cardinality of the set of these functions is in fact equal to the cardinality of the reals. You may already know why this is the case, but maybe we can quickly go through it just so that everybody is on the same page. We can prove this using a technique called diagonalization. Assume for contradiction that the set of all decision problems is countable. Then we could enumerate all these functions f in some way. For example, the first function, let's call it f1, could be written in a table that has an infinite number of columns as follows. So we write down what the result is of f1 of x, for x being the empty bit string, maybe the result is 1. If x is just a 0, then it's 1. If x is 1, it's a 1. If x is a bit string of length 2, consisting of 2 zeros, then it's a 0, and so on. So for each input, we specify what the function value is. Now, we can do this for all the functions. So we do it for the first one in our enumeration, and then for the second one, and for the third one, and for the fourth one, and so on. So we write all of this in a big table. The table is of infinite size. It has an infinite number of columns and an infinite number of rows. But at least conceptually, we can imagine that such a table exists. And now this table should really include all possible decision problems, all these functions f. But does it really? I claim that we can construct a function that is not present in the table. We built this new function in such a way that it is easy to see that it appears nowhere in the table, so no row corresponds to that particular function. For this, we look at the diagonal entries in this table. That's why the technique is called diagonalization. So the diagonal entries here are 1, 0, 0, and 0, and so on. We would go further down. Our new function would now change each of those values. So our new function that we want to construct would say on an empty input, so x is equal to the empty bit string, we would have an output of 0 instead of 1. And then on the input that just consists of a 0, we would get output 1 instead of a 0, and so on. So we just flip all of those diagonal entries, and this gives us a specification for a new function. And now this new function has been missing from the table previously. Because certainly the new function is not equal to the first function in the table, because they disagree in what the output should be for the empty input, for epsilon. It's also not the second function in the table, because they disagree what the output should be for zero. It's not the third one, because with that they disagree what the output should be for one, and so on. In general, it cannot be in the ith row of the table, because the ith row of the table, if you look at the ith column, would disagree of what this new function fnew specifies for that input in the ith column. And therefore we got a contradiction. This new function has not been present in the table, and therefore we know that it's not possible to enumerate all functions in a systematic way. Because the set of all decision problems is not countable, but the set of all Turing machines is, and because each Turing machine solves at most one decision problem. In fact, some Turing machines don't solve any problem because there's some input for which they don't hold. There must be some decision problem that is not solved by any Turing machine, simply because there are many more problems than there are Turing machines. In fact, it's even worse than that, because not only do there exist decision problems which are not solvable by a Turing machine, but almost all decision problems are not solvable by a Turing machine, because the set of all decision problems in some sense is so much bigger than the set of Turing machines. What I mean by this is that, say you would pick a decision problem from all possible decision problems at random, then what is the probability that that decision problem you picked at random happens to be solvable by some Turing machine? The probability for this is zero. I don't mean close to zero, I mean it's literally zero. So almost all decision problems are undecidable. Now, I admit that this argument is a bit abstract, but we can in fact write down a specific decision problem that is not decidable as well. We just use the idea from this diagonalization construction. So here's a decision problem that is not decidable. For input alpha, f of alpha should be 0 if m alpha run on input alpha equals 1. Here m alpha again is the Turing machine that's encoded by the bit string alpha. So in some sense we run the Turing machine on itself. And then we check whether that machine accepts the input, and if that's the case, then the correct answer for our decision problem we are constructing is 0. And otherwise the correct answer is 1, so f of alpha is equal to 1 in all other cases. And basically the other cases are m alpha on alpha does not halt, so it just runs forever, or it returns a value that is not equal to 1. So this problem is not decidable, and it looks a bit more specific now rather than just relying on an abstract counting argument. But the proof essentially uses diagonalization. Assume for contradiction that there is a Turing machine that decides this particular function. Then the Turing machine M needs to halt for every input, because we said if a Turing machine does not halt on some input, it doesn't decide anything. And it also needs to compute the correct result, so for every input x, m of x should be equal to f of x. But now check what happens if we choose as the input the encoding of this Turing machine m itself. So we choose x equal to the encoding of m. Then what is the result that we get? First of all, if we execute m on its own encoding, then clearly the result should be equal to what the function tells us the result is. But this leads to a contradiction, because suppose m executed on its own encoding produces a 1, but then the function tells us that the result should be 0, so that can't be true. And if m executed on its own encoding does not produce a 1 as an output, well then the function tells us it should have produced a 1. So this is a contradiction. It's not possible for this Turing machine m to exist.